the first time this year. And what is the right of territory? And, what is, what did I say was the most powerful first city state?
Yeah.
Silver, okay, that's what you mean, or, what is a city state?
An empire that's one city, like that's mine.
What would, a city state in Wyoming be?
Like the counties, maybe?
Yes, the county, so it would be more than just the city, but the city, everything that that city governs. So it's more like our hearing of what a county is. Okay, so we were starting with the contributions of the Sumerian dynasty. And we ended with a, we said they had microconstruction, okay, and then, what was their social political system?
Theocratic.
Theocratic socialism, so who's Theo? It's actually pretty sure. But, meaning, that God is the ruler. And then the, so we have a democratic, they had a theocratic, so it's a democratic society.
Was it where everyone gets a vote?
Right, and that also comes from the Greeks, because the demos was the city state of the Greeks, so we have, but we, this is a theocratic socialism in which the city-state is dedicated to a particular god, and it is still, you know, coming from the Neolithic period, it is the spirit of the god in certain things. So it could be the god of the sky, which is Enlil, or it could be the god of a mountain, etc., etc. And then the temple was always on the highest point, right, as being closer to the god. And then the so the substructure for the temple, the scribes' quarters, the workshops, the storage areas were around a processional path that leads to the temple. So what's that processional path?
Ziggurat.
Ziggurat. So we said that in the Egyptian society, everything is symmetrical. Oh, Megan was kind enough to put these together.
And then in the Sumer society, everything is asymmetric.
Yeah, so it's very different from the Greeks. Their way of thinking is different. And then we also said that, I don't know if I take your papers. Give you paper.
I should have got my cover.
Okay, so let's see. So the whole system left the ruler vulnerable because he was not the god. They have a different way of thinking. They're the first abstract notation system. Where one thing represents another, right? So, and then we're sort of beginning to investigate Sumer with these early votive figures, and there is a very definite figure type. That is, we still see its powerful shoulders. We see a male figure form, but we see a great deal of decorative embellishment. What else can you say about this figure as compared to an Egyptian figure?
Imperfect.
What did you say?
Imperfect.
Well, it's not ideal, I mean, it's probably their sense of idea, but it's not the general sense of the body beautiful. His arms are way too long, his proportions or anything else. Very large eyes. We all see him. Take care. Okay, so this is 3000 to 2240 BCE. It is, emphasizes the cone for the cylinder. And they, there's a group of them in your text. They're genuinely have been found anywhere from 10 inches, which your page is 11, to about 30 inches in height. And they have a little bit of variation, but they are generally, you should be able to say that these are Mesopotamian figures. This is another one. It is more decorative than telling us anything. Definitely the beard has a kind of definite quality, and certainly the eyes are greatly enlarged in this particular one. I had eyes of stone, precious stones that were inset into his head. I think what's more interesting for me, rather than the votive figure, and again, what is a votive figure? Well, it's sort of a figure that you can meditate on and hope something else occurs. But here is the King of Ur, and this is a narrative relief, a type of plaque. It's a type of plaque that we actually use today. So we got the Mesopotamians. So with this plaque, there's some similarity to Egypt. This is 3000 to 2180 BCE. And it's the King of Ur, U-R, which is in the city's head, on the Sumerian rule. So we can look at it first as, sort of read the design elements and tell me how this is different from the Egyptians.
Well, always it's similar because like the one figure is bigger than the rest. And
yeah, we have sort of big figures of more importance and lesser importance.
They're all on a single ground line.
They are front view shoulders, right side view heads. Both front view of the eye, side view of the feet. And, but what else about it? Because you might think of this as two different sentences. This is the uniform, these triangles and cylinders, they're all over the plaque. It's not as clear, for certain, as the Egyptian geometric simplified form.
Looks like a deeper relief. Looks like a higher relief.
I don't think it's much higher. I think it's a little bit, but not really, because it's the lighting, that we really can't tell you that. Okay, what about gestures? Do you see any similar gestures from Egyptians?
Yeah,
for the pledge, right?
Mm-hmm.
Belonging to, right? So they're all in agreement somehow. But what is, let's put a word here. How is this guy different from that guy?
He's working. Well, he's standing.
Right, so he has a symbolic basket. This is a cornerstone. Here is a symbolic basket of bricks on his head. He's a king in terms of a basket of bricks on his head. Those are the workers. That is the guy how you charge the workers. And then here, he's lifting the toast because the building is done. So this is a cornerstone. So we today use cornerstones when we build anything. There's a cornerstone for this college. And I actually put a drawing inside. Probably this is maybe the roof open it at some future date. So this tells us what happened, and it tells us who did it. And it shows their celebration, their gladness that the building is done.
So both of the large figures are supposed to be Amamu? So both of the large figures are supposed to be Amamu?
It's supposed to be King Ur, the King of Ur.
Was that in Amamu?
Yeah, and he is, the pole is probably where it's attached to the wall. Okay, so it is a plaque, it is a relief of stone, although it is a lot softer stone, and it's celebratory, memorializing this great event. And then in this plaque, we have men and women. Yeah, we assume because they're in laundry gowns. And can you tell what they're doing? Right, they're playing musical instruments, and we're going to look at this type of lyre, L-Y-R-E. What's the difference between a lyre and a harp? Size, right? So a lyre is something that is actually a lot smaller than a harp. And they are women. This is also commemorative, and it is commemorative of a funeral procession. So women were in charge of the deceased, and the women, of course, were in charge of her. So they're female musicians. Also a stone in the funerary players. And then we have actually a very small wooden banner. So that means 8 inches is this height. These are, I think, very, very intricate. And the sort of the feeling of the work in Mesopotamia is this very intricately divided up space. So again, we have a celebration of victory. The important people are holding the first cups, ceremonial cups, were probably of animal horns. And then eventually those horns were cast. So whether you weren't holding the horns drink, you were holding a cast from the horn that you drank from. And so they are all holding horn-like drinking cups, celebrating. And then there's a great deal of the booty of war and the spoils of war. And then the people who are in the movement at the bottom. This is the standard of Ur, U-R. And it is made with wood. And it has been inlaid with not really precious stones, but desert stones, the lapis lazuli, which is the blue stone that we saw in King Tut's coffin, and then the pearlescence of the shell. So very sparkly and bright, let's say. 2600 BCE. Celebrating both peace and war, a military victory. The size of this piece are tiny, and they just give you the inner part. But highly decorative. If you remember that very early painted speaker, where we had triangles, there's all sorts of reference to the triangle still. So this is like the photographic history that they wanted portrayed of their civilization and their life. We have a lyre or harp, 2600 BCE. It's 12 and a half inches in height by 4.5 inches, and that's the sound box and that kind of dimension. The animals of prehistoric have become god animals, both in the Egyptian civilization and among the Mesopotamians. But though the Egyptians gave human traits to the animals as representative of the human traits, right? The Mesopotamian civilization gives the animal more human-like attributes. So they're standing up like a human. At the bottom here we have someone who is half scorpion with a human head and arms and the feet, a goat that is serving. They are involved in this. This is the evolution of Aesop's tales. Fables. It's Aesop's Fables, A-E-S-O-P-S. You have never heard of Aesop's Fables?
Teach you lessons, like more lessons.
How?
Ireland?
Quite an unusual part.
Ireland.
It's only animals, right? So the wolf is always cunning, the lion is always might. The lion can act kingly, or it can act with a viciousness. So in the same way that Leah's work in the art gallery uses insects to represent human behavior, the Aesop's Fables does the same from humans. There are, in later days, they will 1500 to 1800, you have children's stories done with kings, queens, castles, you know, the Wicked Witch, the Old Woman, animals that have changed from a human form into an animal form, and I'm sure that you are all familiar with some of them, right? And then here it's directly the animal is human. There's really not much distinction. So this is the sound box of the harp. If you look back at the harp itself, you see the sound box, and that's 12 inches in height, that is in the front. You see that the oxen is, it's actually a sort of goat and an oxen merged. You know, like a billy goat, it has a throat, it has a beard, and now it has a very human beard.
And, so a lyre is just a smaller harp?
Mm-hmm. And it actually predates the harp music. We also see that the animals are, if we think about an Egyptian cat, Isis, she sits very primly and is all together. Or the deity figure of the hippo, he's just solidly there and doesn't have his mouth open. But these animals are more mobile, they're more flexible, more plastic and feeling. And the negative space created by the artist, crest, and that is a smaller broken up space.
Did you say it was a Mesopotamia that they first started thinking about the negative space? Well, not so much yet.
Not yet. No. That was in sculpture.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So this is a holder for a holder candle. So that sort of spear-like thing on top of it had a candle on it. It's the billy goat or ram and tree and offering stand. And so the goat was the representation of maleness. And in our society, we talk about someone who is inappropriately male as an old goat. So it has come to us down from Mesopotamia. So get this, his name is Tammuz, T-A-M-M-U-Z, and he is the god of male qualities, masculinity. Okay, and in 2340 to 2180 BC, we have another city-state that rises to power, and that is the Akkadians, A-K-K-A-D-I-A-N-S, and it is Akkad, A-K-K-A-D. And something happens in that they have had an infiltration of the Semites, and they introduce a more serious portraiture. This is Sargon, S-A-R-G-O-N, of Akkad, and it is a life-size bronze cast. Personally glorifying the monarch. When we look at the kings of Ur or the little Buddha figures from Sumer, there is really no personalization, so the generic figure. And now we see the ruler defined, but we would know it's from Mesopotamia.
Extremely decorative quality?
To the beard, decorative embellishment. It doesn't tell us there's a chin beneath. It really dwells on the curls of the head. The beard. And the eyes were, even though there is facial recognition, and the eyes were inset with a precious stone. And that is a frontal view. I got where somebody's trying to dig out the stone. And it is a bronze cast. So tell me again about a cast.
Sorry, you make a mold and then.
Okay, so you make something of a softer material. So it could have been carved in wood, could have been animal wax or fat. Accumulated. I would think they probably used to make that easy gold, right? Made a likeness, and then from that positive likeness, they made a gypsum cast, then took that negative and filled it with the melted metal. Probably I would think made of wood, but it's gonna find me done.
What's the date of this one?
This is from the Akkadian Dynasty, 2340 to 2180 BC. Sargon of Akkad. And then we see this interest in professing the self become even greater by the time we get to his grandson. And we see the victory steel of Naram-Sin, or Imhotep important. So Naram Sin, N-A-R-A-N hyphen S-I-N, the grandson of Sidon, 2300 BCE, a stone stele, S-T-E-L-E, what's it, S-T-E-L-E?
Stone
It's 6 feet in height, so it's not a pallet. A pallet is, you're able to hold in your hands, but a steel is a memorial stone, and of a single slab. This is 6 feet by 6 inches in height. Arcadian. And on it we see Man of Sin. Blessed by his stars, which hover overhead, he wears a helmet of ram's horns. That's how masculine he is. And side view, he approaches the top of the mountain, and there is a horn announcing his greatness, and his warriors following him up the high hill.
Didn't it say that he deified himself?
Definitely bragging. Okay, then we have a half century of orange on this one now. But by 2125, we have a city state named Lagash, L-A-G-A-S-H, that dominates. And they dominate from 2180 to 2150 BCE. And in that we see the return of the votive figure from Sumer, but this time in a seated figure. And these figures are almost always done in the same manner. This is 29 inches in height, which is. Knowledge being important, and these are generally meant to be the ruler who was Gudea, G-U-D-E-A, as an architect. So a biography in stone in 2150 from the city-state of Lagash. It is more refined, more detailed, but and it's more rounded. The shoulders, the muscles are certainly more developed.
Is that a different one that's in the book? Did they have more?
Yeah.
Like the one in the book, it's
decapitated. They had one all over the country. So there's ones with heads, ones without heads.
Looks like the one in the book puts the bodies here and the heads there.
So I didn't, I had a few of them that I put in the book. It was more interesting. Still the large eyes. And there is almost a benevolent smile on his face. And his greater articulation in his clothing. But the hair, the feet, the hands still are rather decorative when compared to a more naturalized development. So it's realistic, but it's stylized. And it's decorative. So a seated figure is more human than the standing figure of the Pharaoh of Egypt. The idea of that's actually the same one in a horrible slide. The slides I got from the textbook. They have been over, so Photoshop does amazing little things, but when people don't understand Photoshop, all they do is put in right the contrast. So this is over bright and over contrast. doesn't make it a better image, it makes it a flatter image, right? Close it in Photoshop, stay with bright and contrast, figure out everything else. Okay, and here's one without the head, same pose, this one has a book in his lap. They're all India. There weren't photographs to send throughout the empire, but little statues. So there probably was some individuality.
And wasn't this going on in Lagash at the same time that Acadia was?
There's probably some overlap. Okay, 2125 to 2025 BCE are considered the 100 years of the kings of Uruk, and they use the ziggurat form that we saw in White Temple from 3000 BCE. So a temple at the peak, the tallest point of the mountain, that has been shored up with mud bricks and wood buttressing. So this is just the very top, in a single room temple. Okay, so in our civilization, the wealthy people always are at the highest point of the town, right? Because they're closer to God. Okay, and then the very great, after the political upheaval, yet again, we have Babylon, 1792 to 1594, coming into power under the reign of Hammurabi. So he is the dynastic founder of the city-state of Babylon. He's lost his nose, but this is very much a portrait. We see that he has very weathered skin. He is a wise, elderly gentleman. He doesn't have a turtleneck on. He has a beard that does not show us his chin. You see his eyebrows are just turning a little between the head and center. Emphasis on the eyes and eye sockets. So very much meant to be a portrait. So Hammurabi took the name of favorite shepherd because he was in charge of his people. He was keeping them from danger. The symbolic lion was the danger. If you have a nation that bases its livelihood on goats, essentially, or sheep, related to, then he is the leader. He will save the flock. And that's something that Christians adopted. Hammurabi is known today because he insisted on having a block rule, a unified block rule. So that in this period of time, the leader was also the arbitrator of whatever happened. So if people were having land disputes, they were decided by Hammurabi. And it was the law code came about in the same way that our law code is justified. That is, as things happen, the law code is amended. And in there were traditions within these tribes of what happens to someone. Someone steals, they would have one hand to cut them up. Not so that they couldn't steal anymore, but then they would have to eat and wipe themselves and do all sorts of vile things with only one hand. And they would be outcasts. So the law code was placed on a 7-foot-high steel. And the stone that they used almost universally was Dolerite, D-I-O-R-I-T-E. And it was found much further north, having been taken by the Persians as horrible and much, much better. It was 3,600 lines of writing in the print form, on top of which was a statue of Hammurabi receiving the laws from the sun god. And there again, that's something that was appropriated by the Christians. Moses received his law codes from his god. Then I have two images we're not responsible for, but I really love them. They're from Babylon, and they're very playful, almost, images. This is a lion, a guardian figure from Babylon. Large eyes, so immediately put it in the least.
And the guardian figures?
It could be anything. Could be the guardian figure outside the palace, could be outside the gates, in a very well-to-do home, but a protective figure. And this one is, I'm sure, has been appropriated by later civilizations, because of its almost whimsical appearance. It is Marduk. No, that's what it is. This is the goat deity. But a lot of stylized quality to it. So it looks like a goat, but it's not a goat. It could be. It wasn't named to receive it, so it would hesitate to do that. So you're not responsible for dead or from Babylon. Okay, and then the idea of the really large Sphinx gate came from the north, the Hittites. So about 2000 to 700 BC, was a fairly warlike tribe that lived in the far north, probably what is now Turkey. And they descended into the Middle East and occupied what is now currently Syria, modern Mesopotamia, for sure, the city state of Assur. The Hittites were allies of the Egyptians. Okay, so we had seen in the Egyptian art the idea that you had the body of a lion, the head of a human. And here, it's, even though it's one, you can tell it was much more simplified, much cooler. It didn't envision the entire block of stone. It's by comparison, it's just thick and dirty. But they are marking the entrance gate to their town.
And was this the town of Hazard?
No.
Oh.
And then in your text is this one, and they are not, they're lions.
So the other one, the first one, that wasn't in Mesopotamia, that was somewhere else in
Mesopotamia? Well, it was from the Hittites of the north, and they had descended into Mesopotamia. They took that form of the gate and spread it through modern Mesopotamia, and then it became a tradition among the Mesopotamian peoples. This one is in the text. I believe it's the Lion's Gate from 1400 BCE. So by 1000, it is the city-state of Assur, A-S-S-U-R, and the Assyrian dynasty that rises to power. And their geographic domain eventually controlled all of what is Egypt now by 671 BCE. So they were more powerful than any of the city states we've talked about. Now we see the gate to the citadel of Sargon II from 742 BCE. in the goat's body.
So it's still called a sphinx, even if it's not the lion body?
They had different names for different composite animals, but the Mesopotamian peoples are known for composite animals.
Okay.
So,
the name is actually, for this picture, for the statue, Imansus. Imansus, that's what they call it.
So they had almost a false looking beard as the Egyptians had, because it has become very stylized, like it's more delicate and beautiful than we've seen before.
So they brought that style of beard from Egypt when they conquered?
They probably had some knowledge of what was going on in Egypt. 742-706. They're still very block-like and simple. The palace of Sargon II introduces us to Mesopotamian architecture. Very thick-walled wooden beams, and they were citadels. So what's a citadel? C-I-T-A-D-E-L-S. But there's also something else about a citadel.
Isn't it like a palace that's also like its own city?
It's on the highest point, so that changes it. Now, unlike the Egyptian floor plan we saw, this is asymmetrical. It is not one hallway going down the center. It is a group of built rooms. And what's a room in a courtyard? What's the difference of a hotel? A hotel. In this diagram.
Courtyards are bigger?
The courtyards are bigger. So they still couldn't canter lovers, so they couldn't put a large expanse and cover it with a roof, even a wood. So we have several large courtyards, and then we have almost a maze of buildings. And we'll see that the early Greeks, pre-Greeks, adopted this style of building. This is the Palace of Sargon II at the city-state of Khorasbad, Khorasbad. 722-706 BCE. The lower walls were made of stone, and in an unprecedented amount of room in this conglomeration that is a palace. And I have some of the low relief. This is still a bas relief, but it is different from the Egyptian relief of Narnia. This is a great deal later. Well, what's the difference visually?
Much more different.
There is a greater degree of intricacy. But there's also, in Narnia's palette, you really had two levels. You had a top level and a bottom level, with a little bit of inscription or inscribed lines, like the knees and tendons. But here we have a very delicate presentation of decorative effects, the fur of the garment, the soldier's beard, the hair of the soldiers, the adorned hair of the ponies, you know, lovely curls on their ponies. And some people share from their horses' hair all the time, but they don't put them in ringlets. Here we have ringlets from ponies. And these horses come from a smaller stock. The Houston horse probably is the ancestor of our race horses. Very, very thin legs. So, you know, race horses, if you go to a racetrack, you don't see horses that look like horses around here with big, sturdy hooves. They have ankles so tiny that they often break their ankles by running, and that's their ancestors here. Very delicate animals. Very valued. And how do I know the animal was valued?
So the way it was portrayed.
So
given as much attention as the human?
Well, they're adorned, right? They're celebrated. So we have warriors and horses from the palace of Sargon II.
That's where that relief is from, the palace?
Yeah, from horseback. The group of collection of buildings from that floor plan, this is part of the overall stone slab. They didn't have enough stone to build the entire roofs of stone, but the lower portions were always of stone. Here, another opening. And then this one is under the reign of the Assyrians, but the state, the city is Nineveh. N-I-N-E-V-E-H from 850. And it is the depiction of a ceremonial lion hunt. And this is Ashur Serpal II to the lions. A-S-H-U-R-N-A-S-I-R-T-A-L II in the text. And so here, the real joy of this village is you have the soldiers who have brought the lions together. And then we have the powerful king killing the lion. But it's the lion that is really the greatest actor in the scene. The lions have facial expression. So we have a deceased lion laying on the ground. We have the protesting lion at the back of the chariot, even though he has some arrows in his chest. And then a sort of short circle who has killed the lion. Kind of like that. I hope you've never witnessed a bullfight, but I did. And so what happens is the the toreador does the final slaying, but the picadors come have these picks and they're sticking it into the bull. So by the time the toreador comes out with his cape and his fancy pants, the poor bull is like wobbling from, he's been attacked on all sides. And then the toreador gets the final cut, you know, and the crowd goes wild and I almost blew up. It's the same with the king. The animal has been wounded and then thrown to the king, and then he will make his bravado, you know, he's going to kill the animal for all to see and preserved in all time. And notice the horse in this instance almost looks like a hobby horse or a merry-go-round horse, which actually is an inspiration for. And then I have a close-up of a, you see that the lion getting it in the throat and he's gagging, and then this poor female lioness is doubling over, but allowed to be this show of emotion that we're not going to get out of royalty or any such thing. So a stone bas relief. This one, the dead lioness, also the Nineveh, from the Assyrian Empire. It's dramatic. It's emotional. And there is this knowledge of all of the tendons in the back of the lion's legs. So it's truly accurate. Okay. Then we have a period of invasions by the Medes and the Scythians coming from the east and entering the Assyrian Empire. The Scythians, we don't talk much about,
How do you spell that?
The needs and yes. And the Scythians were a nomadic tribe, Scythians. But they had a very specific art form, and that art form influences the West because they were portable, tradable items, and they had a particular animal style that influenced the Celts. Where are they from?
Ireland?
North of Ireland. Yes, and some were in France. So it's a stylized animal form that was used for adornment. So sort of lion figure at the top is a belt buckle or a harness. And also their use of gold. This is in gold, 12 inches. So with the strapping. And this is known as an animal style. It's a stylized curvilinear line depicting the animal in a very decorative manner. And then the figure at the bottom is a wild goat made of silver.
What was the time of that one?
Okay, so they ranged in the 5th century, sort of around after 612, they invaded in these particular pieces. So that's the 7th century, 612. And then this is slightly later, but it is the style of the Scythians that will contribute to the Irish Renaissance almost 1,000 years later. So we have to make note of the Scythian work. They were never in charge of the civilization. They were just a very artistic, nomadic tribe. Their belt buckles for animals and humans have been found all the way up into the very northernmost part of Russia and across, what's across from Russia?
America?
Wrong direction.
Oh.
Siberia?
Well, the Siberian Peninsula, then it goes over the Swedes, the Lords, the Danes, not named at that period of time, but their land that is now. And then those are the people that went down around the ocean and invaded Ireland. So we carry all these artifacts worldwide, and that's why they're important. Okay, this is a wild goat of silver. Again, this reliance on the curvilinear line, stylization of the animal. So what's the animal style?
Stylized.
Emphasis on the curved line. Decorative quality. Okay, and then eventually the vassals of the Medes take over the entire Middle East, which is really a phenomenon. But just prior to that, Babylon resurges in height of power, and that is the Neo-Babylonian period within the city of Babylon. And here is the great city of Babylon as done by an English painter, and much later. So in the Bible, they talk about Babylon, and they talk about it for two reasons. They talk about the amazing garden at the king's palace, and the king is Nebuchadnezzar, N-E-B-U-C-H-A-D-N-E-C-C-O-R. The Italians would at least give him a nickname. And so we have the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. We know that it was a tradition in Egypt that the pharaoh would have gardens. So Queen Hatshepsut's temple had had major gardens. And then in the far upper top right, you have a cigarette. And as humans are wont, every time something new is built, it has to be the biggest and the best, right? And so the ziggurat of Babylon wanted to be the biggest, but they did not have the engineering capability, and so hence the story of the Tower of Babel in our word Babel. What's Babel? Did I tell you you're babbling?
Not coherent.
They're not making much sense.
So that ziggurat is what's the
Tower of Babel. So it's never completed. Because engineering-wise, they were all arguing with each other, couldn't figure out how to build it. But it was to be the biggest, the largest, and the best. What we concern ourselves with is the entrance gate to the city. This is the Ishtar Gate, I-S-H-T-A-R, from 575 BCE. And it is a gate of glazed bricks. So it's glazed.
So we put a material on it and fire it to make it shiny.
Right, and so the animals slightly protrude. So if you did this one for homework, how would you do it? Besides making your pants up. Because it's monumental.
So are those bricks still stacked with the other ones, but they're just longer, so they stick out in parts? And
so how would you have to make this?
Have to like decide where they were. Either you could decide where they were going to be, or at the end just make the whole thing bigger and then carve everything else out, which would take a little more time.
And then would you carve it before or after you carve it?
Before, wouldn't it?
Right, exactly. So this is fired in place. In other words, they would have had to, which is actually the Asian way of firing, you would have to build a structure and then build a kiln over the structure and fire it. And this is low fired, so it doesn't need to really have a temperature. And it's this beautiful blaze of plume with stylized animal forms that Mesopotamia is known for. Lots of antelope, goats, and lions within Mesopotamia. So it is sort of a meshing of art and architecture together. And the genius of Mesopotamia is circus decoration, decorative embellishment, and a portrayal of animals. What's decorative about this?
The
sort of the archway with those medallions,
yeah.
Right? That's decorative. It doesn't contribute to the structure, meaning to the animals. It's just all decorative. Okay, so I said that the Medes and the Scythians had united and they came, blazed their way into the Middle East. They were not successful, but the vassals of the Medes, the vassals would have been other Persian tribes, they were the whole place of the Mesopotamian tribes, other conquered tribes that were employed by the Medes, they took over, and they were the Persians. P-E-R-S-I-A-N, Persian. Okay, so 612 BC, you have the Medes and the Scythians uniting in an alliance, crushing Nineveh, crushing the Assyrian Empire of the north, and by 523, a very short time later, the Persians take over, who were vassals of the Medes. And they reign 465 BCE, under the dynasty of the Achaemenids, Cyrus the Great, Achaemenides. And they come to power in 552. But
could you say again when the Persians rule?
The Persian Empire begins at 552, but the basis of the empire is really 523. In that period, they are larger than the Egyptian Empire, and the Egyptian and the Assyrian Empire are combined under them. So they're huge. You may have heard of the sons of Cyrus the Great, and Darius and Xerxes. Xerxes is pronounced with a Z, it's spelled with an X. They had no religious structures. The religion is based on Zoroaster, Zoroaster, that is light and dark. And we're going to look at palace. So the palace structure, this is Darius's palace, actually Darius and Xerxes, you can call it just Darius's, but the two brothers, 518, at Persepolis.
I think it says in the book that Xerxes was Darius's son. Yeah.
The names were all repeated ad infinitum.
Oh, so okay.
518 BCE. And you see a relief in the foreground, just a branch from the Egyptians. That's the building, the engineering of what's left of the building.
Postamental.
Okay, this is only a portion of the building. The building, I think, stretches for 7 miles. I heard during the Gulf Wars politicians saying, "Your palaces are so big," but it just happened. This is 550 BCE. You know what I mean? This is always their palaces were built on uneven terrain, and they developed an air shaft. So, in other words, they could have one room on top of another room on this uneven terrain. So, this is the audience hall. Here's a little view of it. What's an audience hall?
Is that where the rulers could, like, people could come to them and confess their problems and they
right,
could deal
exactly.
with it?
So again, the ruler is the arbitrator of everything, and he is an absolute ruler. What he says goes. In this one, you can kind of see that there is a room beneath these other rooms here in the foreground. And then, now, there's the audience. This is the audience hall, and that's the main room of the palace back there. But it's all one palace. So we have probably everybody in the kingdom employed working on this palace to establish it. Here we have a colonnaded room, so that there are columns rather, which is a very elaborate postern lintel.
Where are the lintels, though? Could they?
In the back side, you see lintels, but the lintels must have been made of wood because they no longer exist here. What is important is the capital, the very top of the column, is in the shape of a cradle of bulls. Now, they have lost their horns, and they really look more like hobby horses than bulls because they are so decorative. But you can see that the cradle at the top would have held a choice that would support them, support you. The columns themselves are 40 feet in height. So what's that mean compared to a building?
Four stories?
Yeah, four stories in height. There are 36 columns that are very, actually very slender for their scale. From the Egyptians, there is also this sense of relief. But when we look at the bottom of this, the relief village narrative is more decorative, the narrative, and that would be. Right, so it's a topographical map, and a topographical map changes the you see a line at every 10 feet, so it tells you how steep the terrain is. And earliest Mesopotamian civilization is building on a mountain, carving rooms into the mountains, buttressing. Zigzag path, very top of the hill is the one room temple, and that's the ziggurat. By the time we get to this period, we have adapted to the terrain by building on uneven ground. The use of the air shaft is associated with Persians, the use of tunnels is associated with. Versions. So like all of Mesopotamia, there is a preoccupation with decorative effects over everything else when we come to reading. This is Xerxes giving audience. This is in your text, but you might have a bigger relief form. Do you see what is in his hands? So clearly the one on the back side is a staff, right? And what's the hand in front of him?
Like a cup in his hand?
Not a cup.
Okay.
A chalice?
He's holding a flower.
Oh.
Why would you hold a flower? What does the flower symbolize?
Peace.
Peace.
Then in the book that the theme of Persian release was about harmony, because it was such a large multicultural empire.
Very different from the Egyptians, that they have a flogging device
yeah.
in the hand of the pharaoh. And then they have like both peep staff was hooked to. Why would you have a hooked staff?
Grab sheep,
grab the sheep by the neck. But this is the staff of a leader. Okay, this is 8 feet 4 inches in height and is carved into limestone from 500 BC. This is a look at the first writing we're seeing, orange writing.
What?
It's a gold writing, R-H-Y-T-O-N. So a writing is a certain form of drinking cup. What do you see here? What is that form? First of all,
the horn?
It's held the horn. So it's probably cast from the horn. And then I know it's really Mesopotamian because
decorative and
the animal form. A composite animal, a griffin, which is a winged lion. And then, this is really not a growling line. There is a somewhat musical quality to the line himself. It's the 5th to the 3rd century BCE, that to be Persian. So, the Persians coming out of the nomadic past, you know, because they were a clan that was under the Medes who were also nomadic, have this love of the decorative, the love of the animal form, the use of metals for the Scythians. The Persian Empire is toppled by Alexander the Great. Where is he from?
Greek.
He's Greek. Young Greek.
Wasn't he in the 4th century BC?
He was told, slightly as a slightly new. Well, it could be 4. Could it be like at like 375 or so?
That was like 3. Like, he was in Egypt too, like he conquered Persians and the Egyptians.
So he was told by his father to prove himself as a man, he went out and he conquered the world.
That's a good way to do it.
Show yourself. And Alexander the Great, wrecked the papyrus that was blue-eyed Cuban, which was also his son.
He was what?
A blue-eyed blonde.
Oh.
These are not responsible for because they are much later. It's the House of the Sasanians from 238 BCE. But you see the decorative effects continue. What's at the bottom?
A relief of some kind of animal figure.
Well, it was supposed to be a lion, but it looks like a cat, right? So it is much more decorative.
It's more like an
much
owl.
More
mm-hmm.
playful.
We're not going
his
to
his tail is curving over his body, and it's almost a Cheshire cat in his grin. But the decorative effects are just magnificent. So we have the rise of Islam around the same time as the rise of Christianity.
So are we not going to deal with the Sasanian dynasty at all?
No. And we see inlays of precious stones, all over surface patterning. And what comes with Islam is that the religion itself says there should be nothing that is recognizable. So no figurative work. It should be a spiritual world that's represented. So if you maybe one of your parents has a Persian carpet, it is of a garden. It is not the real world, but it kind of looks floral in its curvilinear line. But the curvilinear line goes all the way back to the earliest parts of the movies and the whole idea of having thin life. So this is turquoise inlaid gold, inlaid in gold. So it's first hammered in gold and then the into the gold has been added turquoise.
How did they keep it in? How did they inlay it?
There is a raised mount of these.
Like, do they like carve a little hole and?
They, not certain. If the use of heat makes an indent, so it probably wasn't hand carved. And then this is an Islamic temple, and you see that overall patterning effect.
Triangles and the decorative.
Yeah, and they, so the artists were really never out of work in the East, but their message changed. The intricacy of the patterns are just pretty amazing. Okay, well, I thought about starting again. I don't want to be behind by the time we get to midterm. I want 2 days of review. So make sure that I'm here. So next class we'll do the GNC culture. Let me just give you a visual on that. Where would I find the GNC? Well, we're going northward, right? And so we're going to be south of Greece. North of Turkey. So here is, we are going to, this is an older map of 440 BC. We are in the first millennia. So down here, over here is Egypt. Right here is the Middle East. And then here is the island of Crete, which is the Minoan civilization. And this coastline will be the Mycenaean civilization. These islands are the Cyclades. We actually start there. Islands are great because they're crossroads. So they're going to assume all of the civilizations that we've studied, the Egyptians and the Mesopotamians, will be rivals among the Cyclades. Okay, so some art history classes in different colleges, you have to name the maps. So each, I have you do that, but I want you to have a geographic understanding of where you have to visit after you do this class. Okay.
Does that say Greece in the age of what?
Pericles. So Pericles is the builder of the Acropolis, which is the highest point outside of Athens. After they defeat the Persians, they celebrate by building the Acropolis. And so that is a whole age of building. He's always depicted with military part, so he may have been a great general and he was given a job after he came home from the Persian Wars, and that was as a builder, the overseer of the project. Okay, keep reading. Aegean Sea culture next.